let me explain what I would like to do with you and with our team of medical clowns. The subject is a subject that I think is a lot of, in Hebrew we say it's very ta'un. It's a very
charged.
It's an emotionally charged subject. And it comes at the end of a very long day. And I imagine that everybody's mind, certainly my mind, is sort of like slowly winding down. And what I would like to do, I'll tell you the structure, the proposed structure, what we're going to do. And we've already decided between us that we're going to be very flexible. Because it's at the end of the day, we don't know you, you don't know us, and we're not quite sure how this is going to develop. The idea is to create not a major experiential session, but to bring you very close to things that you may, you yourselves might have experienced, and then to share the experience of the clowns together with your experiences, with the intention or the hope that it will provide insight into the work of the clown and the way in which clowns are coping with the issue that we have defined as the clown face-to-face death. I realized today that listening to the sessions that death may not necessarily be the most traumatic or intimate of experiences that the clowns are obliged to deal with. That very often there are procedures and pain that may in fact be far more emotionally charged and difficult. But we've defined it as face-to-face with death. It's a subject that I think all of us have some contact with it. And what we're going to do with the structure, I would like to begin with just a very brief, very, very brief sitting relaxation. Very brief, very brief. After which I would like to do with you a guided imaginative journey, again brief, into your experiences. Each person will be sitting and thinking about an experience. After which there will be a moment in which people will be able to share what they have done in their own minds through the guided imagination. And then we will meet again in this group, in this circle. You won't have to get up and walk around. There's no walking around. We'll just do it very quietly, sitting, talking in pairs. After which we will get back into this format and listen to the stories of the medical clowns, the Israeli medical clowns, and hopefully we will generate a discussion. If at any stage, I've described something now which perhaps you weren't ready for. You know, group discussion is not necessarily a guided imagination, not necessarily a relaxation, not necessarily something that you've prepared yourself for. If at any point in the beginning stages, you should feel that you do not wish to be part, you do not wish to do it, you do not wish to go into this guided imagination, you do not wish to share it, maybe you do wish to go into it, but do not wish to share it. At any stage, you can feel free, totally free, just to say to yourselves, I would not like to do this, to yourselves, and simply don't do it. At any stage. We're not going to lecture. This isn't a lecture. It's not a cognitive experience that we're talking about here, but are you registered? Atim Nirshamim, Nirshamtim, are you registered? Okay, that always happens. No. Okay. It is important that you feel free not to participate if you do not wish to. Not even to imagine if you do not wish to. But that is what we will be doing. I begin with an assumption, it's a simple assumption, that the people that have chosen a workshop like this have chosen it, one, because of curiosity, but also, two, because each and every one of the people sitting here have, at some point in their own lives, had some kind of contact with confronting or standing face to face with death at some point or other. And rather than lecture or just simply tell stories, I would like to begin to allow you to simply to connect to yourselves and to see how you connect to this particular issue. I would like to end the session after we've spoken to the clowns and listened to their stories and discussed things together. I would like to, if we have time and if you have the strength and if it works out, the discussion may be going for a long time, the discussion may be quite short. That's life. We don't exactly know how it's going to be, but there are five clowns. And I would like to, as a theatre person, share with you 5 minutes of a particular performance, which I think is one of the seminal performances of one of the great Israeli theatre playwrights and directors, Hanoch Levin, who deals with face-to-face with death through what I consider to be medical plans. So that is what we've planned for this evening. If you feel that you'd like to now get up and leave, you're welcome to do it. Again, feel free. Do not feel that you've been obliged or forced into a situation that you didn't think about or weren't prepared for. Feel comfortable. And what I would suggest is so that we can begin with a very, very simple relaxation. Put all the mess behind your chairs. Those of you who feel most comfortable without shoes can take off their shoes. You're not going to do anything, no running around. But if you feel comfortable with shoes, stay with shoes. I have theater performances in a very small hall. People buy tickets. Once they've bought a ticket, we always have to let them in. And they often come late. They're Israeli, so they always come late, right? And always somebody will come and look in and say, you've got another 5 places there. And I'll say, yeah, we're 10 minutes behind time. Okay, go ahead. And as I let them in, the 5 people come, you know. And so I'm used to the fact that we're going to do it, but it's okay. We'll do it. What I would like you to do is just simply sit on the chair and close your eyes. You've had a long day. For those of you that have taken off your shoes, feel the floor. For those of you that have socks, feel the floor through your socks. Feel the way in which your body is touching and connecting to the chair. Get a sense of the light on your eyelids. No need to open your eyes. Be aware of the play of light and shadow. Be aware of your clothes, the way they envelop your body. We can hear the people talking next door. It's part of the background. Accept it. Don't dwell on it. We hear it, let it go. Feel those parts of your body that are touching your body. Hands on your thighs. Be aware of any areas in your body that may be contracting, stiff, uncomfortable, or the opposite. And as you're sitting now, just be aware of your own breathing, without doing anything to change it. Relax your forehead. If you wish, you can simply take your hand and stroke your forehead. remove the tension, and allow your hand to relax your face. And now what I would like you to do is simply, without opening your eyes, just sit on the edge of your seat. Detach yourselves from the back of the chair. If your knees suddenly touch somebody next to you, just ignore it. There's nothing to be done. You're quite crowded at the moment. Open your legs comfortably. Everybody has their eyes closed, so a comfortable opening of your legs. Let your feet press against the ground. Not press, but simply rest upon the ground, the soles of your feet. Allow your arms to rest between your legs and take a very deep breath. When you exhale, allow your head to simply sag forward, sink forward, stay in that position, and then take another deep breath and slowly allow your head to lead your spine so that it falls down and your hands reach forward until they touch the ground. Relax your neck, relax your face, and gently in this position breathe. Feel the difficulty of breathing. Feel gravity drawing your face and the facial muscles towards earth. Relax your shoulders, your neck, your tongue. As deep as you can, simply take, it's very difficult, but simply take a deep breath and exhale. With the next inhalation, begin to straighten up from the lowest point of your spine. Your head is still relaxed and sinks down until you reach halfway up. At the halfway point, stop and exhale. Relax your neck, relax your face. And once again, straighten up. When you're sitting straight up, try not to open your eyes, but if you do feel dizzy, simply open your eyes and look at a point ahead of you to focus if you feel dizzy. If not, allow your arms to fall to the side of your hips, from your shoulders to your hips. Take a deep breath. And when you exhale, push your shoulders up towards your ears. Very, very hard. Squeeze them. Stay in that position. And then once again, take a deep breath. And slowly exhale, relaxing your back and your shoulders and your face. Take another deep breath. And once again, when you exhale, your head sinks to the beginning, just towards your chin, towards your chest. Inhale once again, bring your head up. And when you exhale, allow your head to sink back. The light will suddenly become very bright, accepted. And once again, inhale to the center. When you exhale, one ear sinks to the shoulder. Your head sinks sideways. Inhale to the center. And when you exhale, your other ear sinks. And rotate your head. Deep rotation, breathing. And reverse the direction. Bring your head to the center when you're ready. If I'm talking a little fast, forget it, just work according to your own pace. And then sit back comfortably in the chair without opening your eyes. Mm. body on the chair. And I would like you now to make a conscious choice of an incident in which you yourselves found yourselves in a situation where you yourselves were standing face to face or confronting or in the presence of death. It can be somebody very, very close. It can be somebody that you've worked with. You may have numerous incidents, numerous events, numerous occasions. But I would like you to take, to make a choice, simply to say, this is the event that I would like to look into. And then I would like you to choose the moment in which you found yourself face to face with death. It may be prior to, it may even be several weeks to, prior to, it may be during, or it may be after. But a moment in which you feel this was the significant moment. And in your mind's eye, as if you are filming that moment, as if the lens of a camera is slowly opening up, I would like you to open up in your mind's eye to imagine that moment, to see that moment. Where are you in that moment? Can you see yourself? It may be that the image doesn't arrive straight away, or it may be that you find yourself in a different image. Give yourself time, and if you are in a different image, something that you didn't plan, stay. I will continue talking, and what is relevant to you, you will work with, and what is relevant, not relevant to you, you will continue your own journey into your own memory. Where are you standing? Or are you sitting? Or are you lying? Are you indoors? Are you outdoors? Allow the camera lens to revolve around the area and take in the first impressions, colors, lights, shapes. Listen to the sounds. Once again, you may not be able to recreate the sounds. Allow yourself to think about the sounds. If they're not there, they're not there. Are there any particular smells? You may actually find that you're in a single position, watching from the side. You may find that you're actually in the part of the activity. Take yourself into that moment. Listen to the sounds. Feel the movement. Feel yourself moving or functioning, static or moving within that moment.
Are you aware of your breathing? Now and at that moment. What is happening around you? Or in front of you? Are things changing? Or is there a moment of suspension? People functioning, acting around you, doing things, saying things. Is there somebody there that you would very much like to be with at that moment? Is there somebody that you would very much like to be with who is not there? What are you feeling at this moment in time? Slowly, in the same way that the camera lens opened up on this scene, at your own pace, allow the camera lens to slowly, close, and shut off the scene. At your own pace, and when you have departed from that moment in time, bring your attention back, your sensibility back to your body on the seat here in Jerusalem, just outside of Jerusalem. Be aware of your breathing. You're aware of your facial muscles. Be aware of light within this room. In your own time, when you're ready, open your eyes. In your own time. Thank you. What we're going to do now, and once again I remind you, if you feel that this is something that you want to keep to yourself, that is entirely yours, feel free to do that. I think the easiest thing would be is if you just simply, even if you know the person or don't know the person, except if we're not doing it, if you would be prepared to share what you've just experienced now with the person sitting next to you, if it's a matter of language and somebody in French, somebody would feel more comfortable with French you might wish to match up with, somebody with Hebrew or any other languages,
You can feel free to move around in the room and just sit together. And all I would like you to do is simply tell what you've experienced to the person sitting opposite you. Simply listen to that person telling you that experience without asking, querying, questioning. Simply listen. Simply listen. And if you feel that you'd like to sit and be with yourselves, feel free to. We'll spend a certain period of time now doing that. And afterwards we'll come back into this frame. You may not have gone to the places that I was talking about. You may have been in a different place, different experience. Maybe you'd like to share that. That's also a possibility. Can I ask you to do that? Simply to, I think the easiest, if there's somebody that you would particularly like to sit to and speak to, feel free to do that. Just get up, take your chair, sit opposite that person, and very quietly, I think we should use the space in the center. Simply tell where you've been and what you've done, but do it in pairs because we're not going to spend a lot of time in threes or something like that. Okay? But feel free, completely free, not to do it.
כן. זה סרט כזה עם...
חופש. התרבות מסוימת, וכאן זה תהיה לו בעולם הפנימי שלך בסופו של דבר.
If you're still the first person counting the story now, could you bring yourself to a position where you change second person for sure? They'll introduce themselves, a little bit about their work, but they'll also tell you their stories. The idea really is to explore with what tools the medical clown copes with situations such as this. And so if you feel that you have questions or comments, we'll open it. It'll be a group discussion. But I think we'll start with Hagar. And yeah, we have to accept that.
We can ask him to turn it down a little bit. No?
Yeah, we can do it. It's not Hagar.
I feel uncomfortable again. Let's just ignore it. I'm used to working in a very noisy environment. And I think we can just.
Hagar. Hello. My name is Hagar, and I'm a medical clown and an actress. I'm not nervous at all. My heart is not beating at all. I'm not sweating. I work as a medical clown in Barzilai Hospital, which is in Ashkelon, very close to Gaza Strip. And I work also in Tel HaShomer, which is in Tel Aviv, in the surgery room, in radiation. This story that I'm going to tell happened in Barzilai, in Ashkelon, and it'll be, you know, excuse the English, but it's not as fluent. So it was a regular day, and I was working in the with the children, and I got this phone call from my friend, saying her sister Evelyn, which has suffered from cancer for a few years already, and she's been in and out of the hospital, and she phoned her on the morning and she said, Evelyn is in the hospital. If you have some time, go and visit her. So I said sure. You know, it was like 9 o'clock in the morning, so I've worked with the children for a couple of hours, and then I was on my way to the to this award when she was 40. 45. So it was a different award. So I was on my way there, you know, with my nose and my hair is like, you know, up like this, and with my bag. And then as I am approaching the award, I'm very close, like the doors are here. I got a phone call from Osnat, this sister. And I pick up the phone and I say, "Hi, Osnat. I'm on my way to Evelyn. I'm going to see her now." And she says, "Evelyn had just died." At that moment, so the doors open, and I'm there with my nose, with my stupid hair, and the family, which is a big family, it's like 11 brothers and sisters, are screaming because that moment that they've heard, that they saw. So screaming, but screaming like I've never heard, something like a, you know, like a native tribe or something like a, really, really, and I'm standing there and everybody's looking at me and I'm like this and I'm saying, what should I do? You know, should I take the nose off or stay with the nose, you know, run away or what? And it was like, I was freezing. I was like just looking at everyone like this. And suddenly one of the sisters, one of the relatives just came in, she grabbed my hand and she started screaming, wow, there's a God, come and bring her alive, come and bring her alive. You know it's funny, but I'm standing there and I'm saying, and I'm looking around, you know, to see if she's sure she means me. And then the son of Evelyn, which was 18 then, screaming, come in! There is a God, come on, make us a magic, bring her back to life, bring her mother back to life. And I'm saying, what do you? And that moment, you know, I couldn't run away because this woman came and just grabbed my hand and she wanted to bring to pull me. She's putting me into the room where everything is there and she's saying, she's still there, her spirit is still here, you can still bring her alive. So she's pulling me and I'm trying to push, but then she's pulling me harder. And then at that moment, it was like a like my soul, you know, is living. I have this bubble here, like in the, you know, thinking bubble. And I'm seeing this vision. I see her and me like in a fight. Okay, she's pulling me and she's like really, really fat, a fat woman. So she's pulling me and I'm pushing and she's pulling and I'm pushing and I'm saying to myself, let go of the hand, she'll fall. You know, when I see, and I let go in my imagination, I let go of the hand and she falls on the floor like this. And it was funny to me, but it was seconds. Crazy. But I didn't do it because, you know, she just died and everybody's waiting, so I couldn't, and she grabbed me so strongly. So she eventually succeeded. She took me into the room and I'm saying, don't look. But I was so curious to see a dead man. And the whole situation, and I'm saying, don't look. But I've looked and I saw, and at that moment, when I saw Evelyn there, like, you know, lying there, and that when I just pushed like really hard and I just ran away. I just ran away from the place. And I was running, and as I was turning around, you know, my nose, I remember I didn't know what to do with the nose. And I was on my face and I said, and I'm running to the elevator. And I got into the elevator, and just in the elevator I was like crying like crazy, but crying. And I'm like, for all my life, I was crying for everything, you know. So I'm trying to press the button, you know, just this button is so hard, you know. I'm just, I don't know where. Suddenly I can't, you know, but I pressed and I'm looking like this, and my hair is like, you know, I'm putting my hair down like this. And there's this mother and this little Ethiopian girl, and she's pushing my dress. Clown. I'm saying, not now, I'm saying to myself, not now, leave me alone, don't. And if I won't answer, she said, go. She goes on, clown, what's your name, clown? I said, Mimi. I got off the elevator and I just ran to the space and I'm changing my clothes and just like, and that's it.
Just one question, I thought I had kind of the answer, but when was this in your clowning career? In the very beginning?
No.
What is the question again?
When did this happen in your clowning career? Was this at the very beginning or were you already experienced?
No, not you know, like 3 years, something like that, after I was in clowning. Yeah. Not in the very, very beginning, but...
Today, when you look back on the events and you tell it now, it has a very comical aspect to it. Do you remember what the feelings were that you experienced at the moment?
I remember I was at the same day. I was there. I was devastated because I was. first of all, I had this voice saying, "You're so stupid. You're so stupid. You did so wrong. Why did you go there? Why did you, you know, like just run away quickly? Yes, you understood the situation. Why?" So first, it was this, you know, this criticism, immediately criticism that I was a bad clown, that I couldn't do anything in that situation. <a bad clown. laughs> You know. That was the first, you know, first thoughts. But then I remember the same day I went to the, I had a show later on, a show for kids, which I couldn't cancel. And I remember I was, you know, I was with this thing, you know, it was very, very strong. The whole day I was, it was going with me. So I came to this show and I was playing this old grandmother. And I'm doing the show, but I'm in a different place. But when, as I finished the show, somebody came and she said, "You were such a, you did such a good grandmother. You were," she was crying, grandmother was a sad grandmother. She's like, "You were." And I remember I left there and I was crying from there. And one more thing, I don't know if you know, but Jews sit 7 days after, like the Shiva, after the funeral. They sit there at the person who died house and people are coming. So I went there and as I entered this place, this room, I remember there was a kind of a hush, you know, somebody said, "She's the clown, that's the clown, that's the clown. She's the clown, that's the clown." You know, and somebody called from Sweden, one of the people there has lived in Sweden, so he said on the phone, "The clown, that must be Evelyn, she's here, she entered the room." You know, and I'm so I was feeling, I was given like this really great job, which I was not deserved, that it was, they were building something around me that was not, that it didn't really do anything.
I think you just mentioned something now which you seem to take for granted and as a given. You actually encountered the family in the hospital. What you just described now is that you actually went to visit them at home. Yes. As a clown or as yourself?
No, as a friend. It's a friend, so I know the family, though I know one of them, I know the family. So it was obvious I would come. Of course I wouldn't do this, I mistake and come with my nose. Learn that lesson.
Remember me?
My name is Javier Katz. This part I don't need to think, I know. My name is Javier Katz. I work in two hospitals, in Rambam, in Haifa, and in El Yafe, another city, little city that it's called. In Rambam, in Haifa, I mostly do oncology department. And that means I'm a clown for 8 years now. That means I have met death many times. I will tell you about mostly two boys. The first one is the first boy that I established with him a strong relationship was a little boy, and I will not tell you about this boy. I just will tell you that he was my first meeting with death in at work, and it was really hard. I was forced to take my house and going to the
balcony
of the hospital, just cry, smoke, go home. I couldn't. These guys continue my work. I will tell you a little bit more about another boy that he was received in the department oncology. Almost at the same time I was beginning my work, and he was with us for 5 years. After that, and he's not with us anymore. This kid was received. His name was Dimitri, not his real name, what a name. Dimitri, because he was Russian, he came from Russia. He was perfect. He was perfect. Every part of his body and his beautiful hair was on his place. And with him, like with any kid, any other kid, I hope you know that all of you know that in oncology there are long relationships. Many of the cases, and the success of our work is based on the possibility of reaching him and having real relationships. That means no too much
distance.
Cannot
just. Defense.
Yeah, it's limited because I cannot like a doctor perhaps just do the work. Yeah. How many of this shit I put in his
veins
for achieving a particular
results.
Oh. I have to reach him, not his illness, not his treatment, not him, her mother, her sisters, all the family, because it's long term and they're all there. With each one of them, also in Dimitri, I choose some channel that lets me communicate with kids. With kids, boy, male, and in this age, many of the times I find in football, soccer, a big issue. I can talk with them. And Dimitri was, I don't know why, but he was
a fan
of football Juventus. Fan. Juventus is an Italian Italian team.
Russian
in a very bad period. They are on the face. He was slowly dying. And his team was losing any single week. I come for I know. Going down and down and down and down and down till now. I'm still I still see if I can any match of Juventus and wish improve. I shout like they had their goals, and I'm sure that he's shouting with me. The difference and the I will not tell every single detail I cannot, because anybody can resume 5 years of relationship in no time. I'll tell you that thing was with us till the end, and you can see even after the end, maybe it's not the end. His body was, he was a short period, he was healthy. And later the illness came back, and he was slow. Slow, and his body was slowly going, surrounding the illness, and one leg becomes short, and the regular, I don't want really come inside. What I try to tell is that I don't know how, but something changed for me during that years I'm working in the department, and one of the difficult things is that you know what is going to happen. If you ask the doctor, you know when, and you know everything. And I learned to stand there with death, and to go when I know where I'm going, where he's going, and in difference of the first case I just named to you, I was happy when my family passed away, because his situation was suffering. It's the point that you know how much it will be faster, it will be better for everybody, including him. And that time when I listened, I was already waiting for the notice of his death. I just keep in my work with other children. And my relationship with him is still around.
Because of the thief?
That's one of the ways I maintain my relationship with him. But yes.
You feel him?
Not that mystic kind of feeling. You know what I mean? He's still a friend. And he's not suffering anymore.
Would anybody wish to relate to what Hagar is talking about?
I'll just say one thing. I relate totally, because I've worked probably out of 23 years, maybe 15 in oncology and hematology. I'm changing to neurology soon. but in the beginning, it was so unbearable to get attached to a child. I spontaneously one day looked at my partner and said, I think I see feathers. It was a metaphor that just got us through the day. And then And another day, Kim looked at me and said, I think I see fuzz. Sat down. And we just started inventing all these silly and funny metaphors. You know, he's in the big elevator to the sky, or he's the prince of the stars. I mean, we make these beautiful names for our lost friends. And even now, in the summer, I try to cut off from the hospital, the clowns, you know. And sometimes I lay in the lake, you know, I like go to a lake every summer to sort of dissolve. And I see birds. And I see flocks of birds, and I call them my birds, you know, sort of my angels, the fairies, I don't know. I somehow feel, I mean, I really, really hear what you're saying. But in a way, I think that poetry and also my partners have helped me a lot to still be here and open the door again.
I'm struck by, I really appreciate the story you both shared, but especially the story of the kind of disaster version, rather than, I think sometimes there's this expectation that it's going to be this beautiful, amazing experience to be with a child that's dying, and sometimes it's just not. I've had the experience of being with a child that really just wanted to be left alone, and it was the family that wanted something beautiful and amazing to happen, all that pressure. And to accept that it's you know, dying is like living. It has all these different facets, and it looks different in every moment, and to just show up and be as present with whatever we find in the room in that moment and trust that's enough. Doesn't have to be sort of mystical in a way. It's encouraging. I think one of my recent challenges is having a clown doctor friend who has a teenage daughter who's going through the experience of having cancer and learning how to be a clown doctor when I feel so much for a family going through it. Just in the last few months, and I found that's harder somehow, because I'm there as Dr. Cheese, and I'm also with the adolescent, and I'm with the parents, and they feel like they're a part of me as well, in a way that I hadn't experienced before as a clown doctor, so that, you know.
Has your friend continued clowning during this situation?
She hasn't, no. No. She's having a break. But she's back in the hospital that she worked as a clown doctor, now with her adolescent daughter, knowing all the staff as a clown doctor. So it's...
We will be continuing with the stories of the clowns, but
I would like to just focus this the question that arises at this moment, right? Because it is a question that I was thinking about listening to two stories, is does being a clown protect you as a person? You know, that I don't require a question, I'm asking a rhetorical question, think about it. Does being a clown protect you as a person? That's why I asked you, is your friend still a clown? You told the story in the beginning, which you didn't continue, and we leave it there, where you said, I took off my nose and I smoked a cigarette and I went home. You stopped being a clown. Hagar told the story now, which when I heard it the first time was horrific. I know those kind of families. It's very typical Mediterranean, Israeli, Levantine families where it can be hysterical. But there was a lot of pain when you told it. Now when you told the story, I heard it before, and the first time I was like, wow, that's really scary. I felt something for you. And now you told it as a clown, it was very comical. Does the clown protect, does the clown persona, that other person that you assume to work in the most horrific, I could never work there. I could never do what you people do. And does it protect you? Does it prevent you from being with yourself? It's a question, I don't want to have you answer that now, but I do want you to think, because I think we're hearing that here, and I think it's important to hear it. One more question. I know there were two. Let's one more question and then continue the clowns. Is that okay with you?
My name's Dan. I'm a physician. I have no former experience with clowning. My question is very simple. Are you, as clowns, most effective when you're pretending and you're being someone else, or when you're synchronous with your own persona? Do you, who are clowns, feel most effective as clowns when you're being yourself in your clown costumes, or you're being someone else in your clown costumes? Are you suppressing your thoughts, your emotions, your feelings, your essence, in order to serve some purpose that seems most easily or effectively achieved by being someone else, or when you're actually yourselves?
I would like, once again, to leave that as a question, if that's okay with you, without getting an answer. I think that part of what we're doing here is just bringing up the questions. Sometimes there'll be answers. I see there are people that certainly are going to color you when you walk out of here.
I know the correct answer.
If you don't know the correct answer, you have to put a big question mark there, right? But the question, of course, is a question. Sorry, that...
Okay.
Okay? I'm sure that we're going to come back to the question. We're going to do something now that I hope is going to work. And that is going to... tell a story in Hebrew. I will translate, unless somebody else feels comfortable translating.
I can help too.
There you go. Please come and sit next to you. Sit here. I need to take a... Maybe just introduce the translator. Your name is?
Yolana.
And she is also American band.
Tell them what my name is, what my last name is, and where I work. Anat Zonenfeld, and you work in.
And you work in Tel Shomer,
Tel Aviv,
in
the operation room and radiation.
ובבית חולים קפלן ברחובות במחלקת ילדים ובניפוי לניתוח.
And in Kaplan Hospital in Rehovot, going with the children in before the operation, accompanying them to the operation.
So we're asking them to test.
Oh, it's beautiful.
It's
the incongruity of the Middle East, but if Israelis know it, we live with such contradictions here. This is part of it, so... Please.
She's telling about an experience of hospice. Is that in English, right?
Yeah.
Of an experience with a child who's dying in their house.
ואמר לי שביישוב שאני גרה, יש ילדה שהיא בחודשים האחרונים של החיים שלה, ואמרו להם להגביר לה.
לא, לא.
Telling her that in the area where she lives, there is a child who's very sick and dying at home. And her biggest wish is for a clown to come to her house. Because I already knew Karen from the hospital, from the radiation treatments, of course I said yes.
חשבתי לעצמי שבמקום כל כך רגיש וכואב וטעון הם רוצים ליצן, זה משהו שאני לא יכולה... כי
Hagar. And I found myself in such a painful and emotionally charged place and request. I can't say no. I really wanted to go, but I was really scared.
בגלל שאני עובדת בבית חולים, אני חושבת קרוב לעשר שנים.
I've been working for 10 years.
וזה המגרש בית שלנו. אנחנו יודעים מה הכללים שם, אנחנו יודעים, אנחנו יכולים לעבוד עם הילד, אנחנו יכולים לעבוד עם ילדים אחרים, ודרך זה לעבוד עם הילד, אנחנו יכולים לעבוד עם הצוות, או יכולים לעבוד עם ההורים.
Because in the hospital where we feel like at home, home base, we know all the people, the medical staff, we can decide, we know the children and their families, we can decide if we're going to work with this child or not work with this child.
לפעמים ילד צריך אותנו, אבל מספיק בבית חולים דקה אחת, שזה ימלא את הצורך שלו במצב שלו.
Sometimes in the hospital, 1 minute is enough to fulfill the specific need of a child.
החלטתי שאני אגדיר את הביקור כשעה כל פעם, מתוך חוסר ידיעה אם זה הרבה או מעט, אם זה מתאים או לא מתאים.
I didn't have any idea what's the right way of doing things, so I decided to put it, my visits to this girl in a frame of 1 hour each time.
ואימא שלה ביקשה שלפני שאני באה, שאני אתקשר כדי לראות אם היא בכלל במצב שהיא יכולה לקבל ליצן, כי רוב הזמן היא ישנה.
And her mother asked me to always call before to make sure that she wants the clown to come now and she's not sleeping.
ובגלל זה הייתי נורא מופתעת, בפעם הראשונה שהגעתי, השתוללה ורדפה אחריי, והתפוצצה בכל הבית. ובאיזשהו שלב אימא שלה אומרת, מה, קרן, את הולכת, את רצה, את משתוללת.
And the first time I came, I was very surprised because she was full of energy and she was running all over the house and yelling and jumping on things. And her mother said, "Wow, Karen, you're..." Her mother was surprised, "Wow, Karen, you're standing, you're walking, you're running,
you're jumping."
At the end of the visit, the girl wouldn't let me go out the door, she wouldn't let me leave, so I tried to leave through the wall, through the table, through the floor, through the ceiling, through the refrigerator, but she wouldn't let me leave, she just stood there.
היא הייתה מחכה כל השבוע ליום שאני אגיע, וכשהייתי מגיעה היא לא הסכימה לאף אחד להיות נוכח בביקור בין שתינו. כאילו היא ביקשה מאמא שלה שתלך, מה שמאוד הקשה עליי, כי להיות שעה שלמה עם ילד שזה אחד על אחד, ואין עוד פרטנרים מסביב, זה מאוד אינטנסיבי.
When I would come, she wouldn't agree anybody else to be there, and she just wanted to be with me one-on-one the whole time, and it was very difficult, very intensive to be just me and the child the whole time with no other clown or nobody else to help with
her. Did you not say that was the last visit? No.
Shema?
זה היה המפגש האחרון?
לא, לא, לא.
No, every time.
תכף זה יגיע, זה יגיע מהר. הדעיכה של קרן הייתה מאוד מהירה. אני ליוויתי אותה במהלך חודשיים וחצי.
I was with her for 2.5 months and her downhill was very fast.
ובגלל שלא היה לי צוות והורים וילדים ו... המפגשים בינינו היו מאוד, ניסיתי שהם היו מאוד, הם היו מאוד אינטימיים.
Because I didn't have anybody else with me, I tried to make them very intimate meetings.
ולמשל שאלתי אותה מה היא הכי אוהבת לאכול, ופתאום שתינו ישבנו ואכלנו גלידה, ואימא שלה אומרת, מה, את רוצה לאכול גלידה? שוקולד, מה לא אוכלת?
I'd ask her, what do you want to eat? And she would say ice cream or chocolate, and we would sit and...
לא.
Sorry, what? What's her favorite food? And she would say ice cream.
Okay.
And then you would eat ice cream?
Yeah. You are good. And then I asked her what's her favorite
color and then I'd ask her what's your favorite color and what's your favorite story.
והיא סיפרה שהיא הכי אוהבת סיפורי פילים, בדיחות על פילים.
say my favorite is jokes about elephants.
והייתי יושבת מקריאה לבדיחות והייתה מתגלגלת מצחוק.
I'd tell her, I'd read her these jokes and she would just laugh like crazy.
פעם היא תפסה לי את המחשבים הפלוצים.
She once captured, she grabbed my fart machine.
שעה שלמה היא עשתה ככה. אני...
For an hour she was...
ואני עושה, oh sorry, oh sorry, it's not... אבל יותר רשעה התעייפתי, אבל היא תקשה, שעה שלמה, כל הביקור עשיתי פלוצים ככה.
I was tired after 15 minutes, but I was forced to fart like that for an hour.
אחר כך בשלב יותר מאוחר, זה קרה לי קרן באופן טבעי, קרה לי שליטה לסוגרים, ואיזה פעם ישבתי לידה, והיא ככה והסתכלה עליה כזו מבוכה, ככה והיה שקט.
And in a later stage, when she lost control over her own body functions, she would fart like this, without control, just look at me like this.
ואז הסתכלתי עליה ואמרתי לה, אל תשמיצי, גם לי יש אותו דבר, אני יכולה לעשות אותו דבר.
So I looked at her and I said, don't show off, I can do the same thing.
ומפעם לפעם היא הייתה נרדמת בזמן הביקור, והייתה מתעוררת, והייתי מתקשרת לפני זה ולא יודעת אם היא תהיה קומוניקטיבית או לא, ומה יהיה בינינו.
And as time moved on, she would fall asleep during the visits, and I wouldn't know when I was then wake up, and I didn't know if she was going to be awake.
זה היה זוי, כי בבית חולים, אני מתלבשת בבית חולים, אני עושה את המעבר לליסן בבית חולים, ובשום, ביישוב שלי גרה, הייתי מתלבשת בבית, כולם מכירים אותי בשום, זה יישוב קטן, אני עושה, מה הפתאום בבגדים באוטו, והייתי אומרת,
The hospital, I have the space where I get dressed and turn and get into my clown outfit, but here, in Shoham where I live, I would dress and drive to this girl's house and think, what if somebody I know is going to see me like this?
זה היה כל כך מעייף, הייתי יוצאת משם החוצה אחרי שעה, ואני זוכרת שממש פיזית הייתי עושה...
It was so exhausting that after I left, I just have to go like this. I just didn't have any energy.
הייתי מאוד, אני כמובן הייתי מדברת עם האימא ועם הבבושקה, הייתה שם הסבתא, הייתה שם המורות, וזה נעשה משהו משפחתי, כי קרן חלק גדול מהזמן כבר לא הייתה כל כך יכולה לתקשר איתי.
At a later point when Karen couldn't communicate anymore, I would talk to her mother and her babushka, the Russian grandmother, Nikor, and the nurse, and she couldn't communicate.
ואז יום אחד, זה קצת טרי, זה
קצת יום אחד. It's a little bit fresh, so I'm going to cry.
So one moment. Maybe I will need this one. Where is my tissue? Okay. טוב, אז יום אחד, אני מתקשרת אל האימא של קרן בבוקר, ואומרתי, עכשיו את יכולה לבוא עכשיו, עכשיו תבואי.
One day her mother called me and said, come right now.
אז אומרת לה, בטח שאני יכולה לבוא, אני באה, אבל מה...
Of course I'm coming.
אבל מה עם קרן?
But what about Karen?
אז היא אומרת, קרן איבדה את ההכרה.
Karen lost consciousness.
אנחנו לוקחים אותה לבית חולים. אז אמרתי, בטח אני באה, אני מתלבשת ואני באה. ואני מתלבשת מהר בבית וזה, והבת שלי שואלת מה קרה, ואני אומרת לה, אני הולכת לקרן.
We're taking her to the hospital now, so I said, of course I'm coming. I got dressed pretty quickly, and my daughter asked me what happened.
ואז פתאום נופל לי על הסימון, ואני אומרת לעצמי, אמא של קרן קוראת לי לבוא, אבל קרן בכלל היא יקרה. אני לא באה בשביל קרן.
And then I suddenly had the realization, Karen's mother is calling me to come for her, because Karen's not conscious right now.
אז אני לא באה לקרן, אני באה לאימא
שלי. I'm not coming to Karen, I'm coming for her mother.
Or maybe all the family.
Or maybe all.
ואז אני...
שלי, אני אומרת, בנקודה שהחיים כמעט מתרסקים למשפחה, שזה אין שערה וכאב גדול מזה, היא עוצרת רגע וחושבת שאני יכולה לעזור.
And then thinking to myself that at this crazy point where this family is going through such a difficult, horrible thing, she thinks that I can help.
הפער הזה בין הליצן שהוא רואה את עצמו טיפש וחסר אגו לבין המקום שהם נותנים לי, הילדה שלה זה שעות האחרונות והם קוראים לי, וזה גם מחזיר לי לסיפור של הגר, שהם חשבו שהגר תאיר את המטר, הם לא אמרו את זה בצחוק, הם חשבו שהיא תאיר את אבלים, כי זה לא יאומן הפער הזה, הקונפליקט, לא יודעת להגיד אם הפער הזה בין שני הדברים האלה.
I can't comprehend the distance.
The disparity between how the mother clown, sees me and how I see myself as
the
clown.
The clown sees him or herself as stupid in it, and then these people have these expectations, this mystical that the clown is gonna, like in Hagar's story, is can bring the dead back or do something, some miracle at this moment.
מה יש בליצן הזה שיכול לתת משמעות וכוח במקום הזה, בנקודה שהם היו, שילדה שהם הולכת עכשיו לבית פולים, היא כמעט מתה.
What is there in the clown that can give strength in a moment like this where their daughter is about to die?
אני לא יודעת את התשובה, אבל זה כל פעם מחדש כל כך מרגש אותי. כל אופן.
I don't know the answer, but just this thought each time is so moving to me.
בכל אופן באתי לשם הבית, קירן שכבה, היא לא הייתה בהכרה. כתבתי אותה, אני נגעתי לה מפוחית, שרתי לה שירים.
I came to her house and she was unconscious and I sang to her and stroked her and played the harmonica.
והייתי עד שהגיעה האמבולנס.
Until the ambulance came.
אז חיבקתי את האמא והלכתי.
And then I hugged her mother and left.
אחרי שהייתה בהוספיס, רגע, יש לי עוד לגמור את הסיפור. הייתה בהוספיס ובאנו לבקר אותה גם ואני עוד פעמיים.
The Karen was in a hospice and Hagar and I came to visit her and she came to visit her twice.
ובאמת משפט לסיום, שכשהיא נפטרה מאוד התלבטתי אם ללכת להלוויה או לא. מתוך מקום של המטפל, איפה עוברים את הגבול, אולי אני כבר חציתי את הגבול בזה שהלכתי הביתה ולא היה לי הדרכה. כן ללכת, לשמור על עצמי, לא לשמור על עצמי.
When she passed away, I was trying to decide if to go to the funeral or not, and was wondering if that's crossing the border, but maybe I already crossed the border by going to her house without anybody helping me with this the whole time.
הייתי בהלוויה.
And I went.
Thank you that you let me off the hook. I'm not a very good translator, so that was wonderful listening to Yolanda translate. But I would like to reiterate a question that you asked that has, I think, haunted me for over 30 years. The clown is a ridiculous, silly figure. What is it about the clown that gives rise to these strange, almost mystical expectations? In the case of Hagar, bringing the dead back to life. In the case of the mother, the child is unconscious, in a coma. Why call a clown? What is it about, I've researched clowns because that is the question. What is it about the clown that makes the clown be present at these most traumatic, intimate, sad moments? Why do people turn to the clowns? I've been researching that for 30 years. Thank you, that was lovely, wonderful. Tada Rabba, sorry. I would like to continue. Is everybody still here? Okay, I know it's been a very long
I'm going to give up on the theatrical thing. I think that we have Hamutal and we have Talia, and I think that we should certainly listen to these clowns. I think the stories are opening up, but for me it's opening up a lot of questions and giving me a lot of things to think about. Hamutal or Talia, which of you would like to?
listening to my friends here and something is happening to me because I didn't prepare any story to tell, not that I'm inventing them, just say I will be a medium, whatever comes I will tell. I don't know what is the best death story to choose. I've been working 9 years in a hospital and I feel I have a dialogue with the death that is developing. Of course it connects to my personal life. When I started to be a clown, I remember saying to myself, if this child that I love so dearly, and I spend every time I come to hospital, the most time with her playing, and if something like that, dying, death, if she will be gone, I will never ever be a clown doctor anymore in my life. It didn't happen. I continued. And I take what you said about using frames that helps you live with that. Like sometimes I'm coming to hospital and I hear a voice or a laugh or I see like a brown-haired girl running and I think, wow, she looks exactly like Marianne, and Marianne is dead like 4 years now, but maybe it's her. Like, I have so many friends that are in between worlds, or for me, they still exist. And there comes Sunday, I'm in the oncologic department, and a new child is coming, and it reminds me so much of my dear friend that is gone. So sometimes I'm confusing. But one thing I know for sure, when I will be dead, there will be many, many, many friends waiting for me there. And it makes me feel good. Like, maybe I'm a bit less afraid of dying, because my grandma will hold all these beautiful friends that once were here and now they're not, and they were all like, oh, Tanya. So, yeah. I hope it won't be painful.
I will wake you also.
Anyway, I would like to choose a story that, of course, all the story I would like to say, they cracked me a bit, because there is this answer for your question that says, as a Talia, I'm a very anxious person, a very Polish mother, very, but as a clown, I'm completely looking at things like through my nose, through my eyes, and say, wow, you're bleeding. Wow, you have a lot of blood, you have something. So I'm looking at it differently. I'm using different sights. And this sight, it makes my barriers much more.
My defensive.
Yeah, I don't have a defensive. I'm very open. And because I'm very open, I meet things that I believe suits my openness. They're coming to me, I'm not choosing them. To this one. What should I tell? A very, very dear friend of mine, 22 years old, while he was in the children department, because he had a children cancer. And he was very, very, very handsome. Like, yeah, of course I'm married and everything, but every time I saw him, I felt like, wow, such a handsome guy. And my clown felt it. And he always, my clown told him, like, you are so handsome.
And your clown is not married.
לא רק לא, but always we talked about many things and very openly. And like, you don't want to embarrass 22 years old with your reddish nose. You want to be with him at the same level, like you're with children, like you're. So one day he came to me and he said to me, Lulu, it's the name of my clown. Bye bye, I'm going. I finished with cancer. That's it. I'm clean. My blood is clean. I'm going home. So I wanted to say thank you very much for everything, and I will come back as a volunteer to work with you. And I said to him, don't dare to come as a volunteer to work with me. Go to Thailand, go to, I don't know, do a lot of drugs, do whatever you want, but never, ever, ever, ever come here to work with me. And Kishta. Anyway. And then he came back after a month and he said, I'm sick again. I said, okay, so now we are together. Let's work together. And we were together many things. So I would just like focus. I think in the third time that the cancer came back, I just finished my shift. And the always in the oncologic department, they give you very, very nice thing to eat because these children, they cannot eat because they suffer. So they always, I don't know why in Israel, they bring a lot of like pancakes and popcorn and like things that makes this smell of food everywhere. I don't understand it, but I work with it. So I took popcorn and I was eating and going off. Like I finished my shift. And then I saw him and I say, hey, Sam, was his name? Sam, what's up? Do you want to come with me to a movie? And he took my popcorn and he said, I am in a movie. All my back is full with cancer. And I said, wow, and who is starring? Brad Pitt? And he said, no, I'm not the lead actor. And he started to like cast the film of his life. So I went with him to the, hello, he said, to, like in the reception, I have an MRI, my back is full, so wait with him. So my shift was not already my shift, it was like, I didn't went home, I was with him, I couldn't leave him, but I was all the time joking like mad woman about the film and what would be in the film and if I can play too, because I always wanted to be a famous actress, but I've ended up being a clown doctor, and so I really want to be in his film, and this is my last chance because maybe he doesn't have a lot of time, so this is his last film, so maybe I can. And he was like really with me, and we did another popcorn, and in the end I felt maybe it's time to go home. Because I have babies waiting for me, and my husband needs to go to work, so I have life waiting for me. So I said, okay, we see each other again. Soon you'll be here a doctor, so bye, I'm going to my car. And as I sat in my car, I started crying. Because I understood I'm going to lose him. I'm going to lose my friend. And this is a fact. And I was trying to be with him all this time. The other day I saw him was when he was waiting for his blood test. So it was, there is always a queue. And nobody in Israel respect queue. So everybody is like, you're in the queue, I didn't notice. So that, and it's like, everybody's sick there. And everybody is suffering. And this 8 months baby and 20, like there is everything. So I was like standing on the chair and saying, I'm sorry, but there is a VIP. The guy has third time cancer. Please find a place to give him to be first, because you have like to take a, like, you know, coffee, one to three, and the 10th one is free. So I said, the first cancer is free, so let him pass. And his mother, his French woman, was like, oh, Lulu, I'm sorry. She was so, and he was, yes, let me pass. And he passed all the way in the blood testing, like, and he was the first because he had the third time. And I was like guiding the door, like, this is, he has the free one. This is what I could do. But this was out of my despair as well. It was very funny, but it was like I felt him like in my body, and I was angry that he is going to die and I'm going to lose my friend. He was such a sweet, handsome guy, and I was like jumping into this thing, knowing I'm gonna hurt myself because I am being his mouth, being his voice. You know what I mean? Maybe you don't.
We do.
Anyway, I don't sure I know what I mean, so because of that I'm asking. But anyway, he, of course, lasted for a long. He didn't let me anymore come closer. He was in the hospice, and every time I came, his girlfriend went out, and she said, "Please talk to me. He doesn't want to have company." And so I was just standing near the door and saying, "I can smell your perfume. I can really smell your perfume, and it moves me." I was like really screaming to him all the time, even if he doesn't. And I saw him waiting in the ambulance, and I said, "I can smell your perfume from here, Sam!" And he was like, "Okay." So I was like a disappearing friend. It's okay. It's my job. And I bought him a book. Maybe he read it, maybe not. That's it, I think, with my story.
Before we continue with Hamutal, I'd like to make a comment here for people who have come from overseas. In Israel, if you want to be disparaging towards somebody who is not connected to reality, you say, "You're living in a movie." Tachai b'seret. You know, you're living in a movie. And it's a very disparaging thing. You know, you're not connected to the reality of life. What we're seeing here, or the story that you've just told, is so typical of the clown that crosses the boundary and says, "I can live in a movie. I can make this a movie." That's snubbing your nose at reality and saying, "That's my prerogative. I can do it." That's the clown. Very interesting story. Thank you very much. Stay with us, we have Hamutal.
I won't tell a story because I feel it's not right. I will just say something that I'm dealing with when I see people that I am being told they are going to die. I'm saying I'm being told because I came to this position where I see a child and everybody tells me, also Javi, I work with Javi, and he says, "Listen, this is, I don't believe. Nobody. Like, the doctors can say, I don't believe." I say, "What do you know? You know, you're not God." That's why I say, they die mostly. But I don't believe. I have this thing that doesn't believe. And what is hard for me is, and in that place, it's hard for me to be a clown. Like, you know, when your mind is talking and you cannot be a clown? To be in the other side. All the time. I don't want to be in their side. God forbid I want to live 120 years. But to always to be in the other side and like to see it, and I say, like a child or a grown up, allow, if I was him, I would say, "Oh, I wish I was her." And it's like, I feel it's a problematic place to be. I feel like not fair.
What not fair?
I feel it's not fair.
What?
That all the time I see a Yuval, she's 12 and she's dying. I see Ala, they say he is dying. I see her, I come to a place and the nurse says, "Go to him, he's going to die, he has cancer all over." And I look at the man and I say, what the fuck? Why is he dying? You know, he's my, always to be in the position that is living.
And I want to live. I don't want to die. But this position, I feel like, I don't know.
What is not fair?
Yes, I mean,
I feel not...
She's going to live, and then...
No, she's going to die.
She's going to die.
She's going to die.
No, no, no.
No,
no,
no.
Yes.
Never,
I say,
never.
I say, maybe this is a problem I have, that I don't think I'm going to die. From
maybe.
There it's coming. But maybe, no. Because I think our job, you know, it meets us in our place in life. It meets us in our... where we are. But, okay, I'm going to die, but he's dying tomorrow. And he's younger than me. And also her, and also them. And all the time to meet people that are going to die. You know why? It's just not comfortable anymore, you know?
She said
it's
when she meeting the dead, she doesn't feel comfortable.
And it, when I get, when this comes into my mind, it doesn't come all the time. When it comes to my mind, I'm blocked. I cannot work. And I do this. And I have to struggle to get out of it. But my mind starts working and I see this little thought and I'm like this. It mostly happens with more grown-up children and not babies. But, and just one more thing and that's it. I think the parents, because I had a friend that died, and he was 13, Daniel, and the morning he died, his mother called me up and said he died. And you know, she called me up before the funeral of her son, but I was his friend.
As a clown?
I know, yes, Susie was his friend. And this is a boy that didn't have a lot of friends because he was sick for a long time and he was in the hospital for a long time. And she wanted, we are friends of the children. And that's how the parents, I think, like see us a lot of the times. And they want to share it for the child that is dead already. They want to share.
I'd like to say something. It is different. We work two people, and this is a situation where I think it's good to have a second person. I just tell a very short story. It doesn't happen often, but we were in the hospital, and there was a boy that we knew, and he was very, very like excited when he saw us. He was from Dubai. He spoke perfect English at 9 years old, and it was really fun with him. We had a lot of fun with him. And then the nurses said, he's dying. And they called the Muslim priest, and it was really preparing. They wanted to bring him back to Dubai. He didn't make it. But we went into the room, and the nurse said, he's looking different. So we went in, and both of us started singing a song or doing a rap or something, and he wasn't really responding. He was on a lot of morphine, and I thought, that's not him. It's someone else. And, I mean, Jermaine thought that too, but we didn't say anything. We were singing, and then it just was... The song was inappropriate, and then we looked, and we thought, okay, we always... sing one song when someone is dying, and often they die after that, and that's a song that we learned from Laura. And then we sang this song, and it was very emotional and very, like, it was just incredible, and the parents were there, and then he looked at us and smiled. And then we knew that it was him. And we left the room, and we thought, we have got to have a drink or something, and talked with the nurses and said, was it really him? They said, yes, but he changed a lot. And this was an experience that was beautiful. And so for me, death, it's not so scary. But,
coming to this from sort of a chaplaincy direction, and I'm wondering whether any of you have had experiences with the chaplains, you know, sort of approaching these moments of death and what those interactions have been like. And also, you know, sort of one thing I'm starting to sense is that chaplain is like the priest or the rabbi. Spiritual accompaniment. And I was wondering, like, because so many of these stories are in some way sound to me like stories of resistance against death. And that there's always this moment where the death is proceeding and the story no longer matches with the experience and the pain of that kind of departure of ways. And I'm wondering whether anyone's had experiences of trying to take that story, that fantasy, and work with the movement towards death in that kind of storytelling that I guess we all do, you know, chaplains and rabbis and clowns as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's nice because it's a continuation. I worked for 9 years, and I became a mother during starting a clown as a single and then having kids and its effect emotionally, and I learned to accept death, and I learned I have my own story to make it to make sense out of it. It's as if for me there is a continuation. And I understood that there is this spiritual mission that in Israel it's very hard because Israel, it's a country that suffers from, it's not, you know, we die here from many things that are not disease. So all that, sorry, is my way to express it, but it's very taun.
Cha.
Emotionally.
I remember I've been to Mexico in the death holiday, and I was so inspired by that. Wow, you do a picnic on the grave, it's beautiful. But then I thought, okay, I have as a clown saying the, I can say, oh, the shaman for the 2000, it's the shaman way, maybe. I do think there is a spiritual mission, but as a person, I'm not always I can be there, you know, not always I can do that. I start to work in a neonatal department, and I see, sometimes I come to the department and there is a baby that was just, he was just born, and there is something fucked with the birth, and you know, you see a father standing and everybody tells you, he's going to die very soon. And I feel, you know, my heart, and I feel, it's not, I think the clown see the healthy side. So this is why I can see as a clown that there is, okay, it's a continuation, it's a part of the life. And I can maybe help to, you know, like a bridge. Not as a person, because as a person I'm but sometimes I feel I'm free, I freeze, I can't do that. Sometimes, and I still, I don't understand why sometimes, why, what is different? I mean, I have, when you did this session, I have a father that I could see from him from the glass. I was in, there is two rooms in the neonatal department. There is the emergency and there's the other one. And nobody could stand, I mean, all the nurses were like next to me, giggling, and I could see him, and I felt, I want to go there and to put my hand on him. He was alone. His wife was just, you know, just gave birth, and this is an emergency other room, and his daughter would just, she's going to die. And I felt, wow, I just put my hand on him. But then I start to think, should I take the nose off? Should I put the nose off? What should I do with the nose? Do I need the nose? Do I not? And this is like it stopped my movement. You know, it stopped the once we start thinking, it's gone.
I would like to wrap up at this point and say, firstly, I...
No, maybe.
I'm very much...
this conversation.
I'm very...
central.
It's not fair.
I genuinely appreciate the fact that all of you have participated in this. I realize, you know, this is, I don't even know why. I know why I chose this particular theatrical event.
Show us.
That I want to do, analyze purely academically as a theater person. And somehow, maybe because of something that Anat said, it spun around and became this session. I appreciate the fact that you have stayed in the session, that if you participated in the session, either simply within yourselves, I believe very actively, the comments that you have said, a lot of things have come up and have not received replies. I'm sure that this will be something that will continue. People will continue talking about it. I'm sitting here and I'm saying, how can I even think that 30 or 40 people can sit down and discuss this topic in such a way? And then I said to myself, this is what medical clowns do more than talk. You know, and I was fascinated this morning listening to the doctors who also do the same things, but the statistics and the measurements. And you know, I'm always fascinated by doctors. I come from a family of doctors. They call me the doctor clown. I can deal only with clowns. But I think this is the thing. This is the real thing. And I really appreciate it. I thank you for having been here, for having listened and participated.
Oh yes, the meaning of life.
Yeah, all you need is look on the bright side of life. Okay. Thank you very much. Have a pleasant supper.